Thank you and be seated. We're going to turn over the service now to Brother Johnson, our minister of music, and our choir and cast for the presentation of the Centurion. And I believe it's going to be a blessing to you. God bless you.
Well, welcome to Worth Baptist Church. I notice that we have many, many guests here. This is the final performance of The Centurion by Ron Hamilton. And tonight, the question will be posed to you. What will you do with Jesus? Our main character's name is Justice, and you'll be introduced to he and his wife and his child and his circumstances as he goes throughout all of the Roman Empire, coming face to face with Jesus Christ. And as he sees Jesus Christ, he is confronted with that one question. What will you do with Jesus? Tonight, answer that in your own heart. What will you do with Jesus? If you have your programs, take that out and look at the very back of the program. You'll see a phrase written, Jesus Christ is risen, and he liveth forevermore. Let's repeat that together. I'll say, Jesus Christ is risen, and you say, and he liveth forevermore. Jesus Christ is risen.
And he liveth forevermore.
Oh, that's a great statement. And that, in fact, that's the theme of tonight's performance. Jesus Christ is risen. He's no longer dead, and he liveth forevermore. Tonight, we hope to portray through the acting, through the music, that not only was Jesus powerful back then, 2,000 years ago, taking care of healing people, saving sinners, but he's also doing that today, and he can do that for you today. The question is, what will you do with Jesus?
Jesus Christ is risen, he is risen, and he liveth forevermore. What do you think, Julius?
Don't worry about me, Father. Those rocks didn't hurt me half as bad as they hurt Mother. Besides, I'm old enough to defend myself.
You'll make a good soldier, Julius.
If he lives that long, why can't Julius stay at home and be a peaceful youth?
Because, Helena, men are not made in the kitchen, clinging to their mother's skirts. A growing boy needs a good fight now and then.
Especially if he's going to be a centurion like you, Father.
That's right, son. Now, don't worry, Helena. Julius will be all right. We'll all have some adjusting to do to life here in Jerusalem. By the way, after you've rested for a few days from our long journey, we'll be taking our first vacation.
Already? Where are we going?
Have I ever told you about a wealthy man named Marcellus who used to work with my father in Rome?
I think so. Isn't he the one who taught you how to use a sword?
Yes, in fact, he gave me my first sword. Marcellus is now overseeing the affairs of Rome in a small town located in Galilee.
Are we going to visit Marcellus, Father?
Yes, Julius. Pilate is sending me to Galilee to gather information about a certain Jew who is organizing a rebellion against Roman authority.
Do you think Marcellus would be brave enough to play gladiators with me?
If I remember correctly, Marcellus has a son just about your age. No doubt he'll be happy to match swords with you.
Sir, there's a man at the gate who wishes to speak with you.
What does he want?
He said he had some business to discuss with the new commanding centurion.
Very well. Send him in.
Thank you for seeing me, Centurion.
You're most welcome, sir. What business brings you here?
In the past, I have supplied all of the Roman soldiers in Jerusalem with tents.
Then you shall continue to do so, if you do good work.
My family makes the finest tents in the Roman Empire.
If that's so, then you have nothing to fear. You shall have my business as well. Good day, sir.
There is one more matter I wish to discuss with you, Centurion.
Yes?
This morning, I discovered that one of my men cheated the Roman government by charging too much for some tents. The man has been punished, and I wish to restore 4 times the amount that the government was overcharged.
Are you aware that I could have you beaten and imprisoned for defrauding the Roman Empire?
I am.
Then why do you risk so much to restore so little?
Centurion, a healthy conscience is worth far more to me than a healthy body.
I shall not forget this. You're a man to be trusted. Are you a Jew?
Yes, I am a Pharisee of the tribe of Benjamin, and I am also a Roman citizen.
Are you familiar with this Jewish man who is supposed to be able to perform miracles?
The man you speak of is a peasant from Nazareth named Jesus. His clever tricks have deceived many uneducated people, but no educated Jew has been fooled for a moment. The elders of the temple are doing all they can to expose this imposter.
Thank you so much for that information. By the way, may I ask your name?
My name is Saul, Saul of Tarsus.
This Jew had made an impression on Justus that would be remembered for years to come. Several days later, Justus and his family left Jerusalem, bound for the small town of Capernaum, located in Galilee. Helena was relieved to get out of Jerusalem, and Justus was eager to see his dear friend, Marcellus.
The years have been kind to you, Marcellus. You look exactly as you did 10 years ago.
Thank you, my old friend. This peaceful life by the Sea of Galilee does me good. But you've changed quite a bit since I first taught you to use a sword. But your son looks just like his grandfather.
But I don't have any wrinkles, do I, Father?
No, son. At least not yet. By the way, Marcellus, where is your son? Julius has been very eager to meet him.
Well, the last time I saw Stephanos, he was down in the gardens battling one of the meaner-looking statues. But I'm sure he could use some help, so Julius, why don't you go see if you can find him?
May I, Father?
Sure, you may go, but don't kill any statues. That's the way you ruined your last sword, remember?
Yes, Father.
So, Justus, how do you like military life? Is the son of the Senate's president happy with the life of a lowly centurion?
I'm quite content for the present.
Well, then tell me, Centurion, what important military business brings you to little Capernaum?
Pilate has sent me to Galilee to gather information about a certain Jew who claims to be one of the gods. Have you heard of this man called Jesus?
Let's discuss this another time. My heart is too happy. My son has just recovered from a serious illness, and now my good friend from Rome has come to visit me. God is good to me.
During the coming weeks, Justus traveled throughout Galilee, gathering all the information he could about Jesus. After about a month, Justus returned to Capernaum to be with Helena and to discuss his findings with Marcellus. Julius and Stephano spent most of their time playing soldiers by the Sea of Galilee.
Marcellus, where are those two great soldiers of ours battling today?
Well, they called off war for the day so they could go fishing. One of the local fishermen offered to take him out in his boat, so I got him up early and packed him a lunch, but, you know, we'll hear from them as soon as they get hungry. But now tell me, what have you learned about this Jesus?
I must say, it's been very difficult to find Hebrews who are willing to talk. I have, however, heard Jesus himself speak on two occasions.
And what did you think? Did he impress you as some dangerous rebel who's going to overtake Rome?
No, I heard not a word about Rome. Instead, Jesus spoke of a place in the heavens where he and his Father live. Then he spoke about a place that burns with eternal fire called hell. He said that every person would spend eternity in one of those two places. None of it made much sense to me. I expected to come and find a violent man whose words were cruel and bitter. But Jesus is a man of peace and kindness.
But did you get close enough to speak with Jesus?
No, the crowds were always too great. I did watch from a distance, however, as he performed some of his so-called miracles. Tell me, has anyone been able to find out the secret to Jesus' tricks?
He has no tricks.
Marcellus, surely you of all people don't believe that this man can do the impossible.
Justice, 10 days before you came to our household, my son Stephanos was going to die. We took him to all the best doctors in Galilee. They all told us the same thing. My son would be dead within the week. Then I heard that Jesus was in Canaan of Galilee, and my son's health was failing fast, and I was desperate. When I finally found Jesus, he calmly told me that I could return home, that my son would be healed. Now, I too thought him a trickster. But when I returned home, the servants met me at the door and told me that my son was healed. And at the exact time I spoke with Jesus.
Well, what did the doctors say?
They had no explanation.
Certainly, there must be some explanation for what happened.
Father, I saw him, and there are 5,000 men all around him.
Whoa, Julius, slow down, son. What's the excitement all about?
Late this morning, we saw thousands of people on a hillside, so we went ashore to see what was happening. After we pushed our way through the crowd, we saw a man speaking and healing people. Then this wonderful man asked if he could have my lunch. Well, I didn't know what to do, so I gave it to him, and he broke it into pieces and gave it to everybody. Father, my little lunch fed all those people. In fact, there are 12 baskets left over. I even brought one home to show you. Look, Father.
Marcellus, I have much to report to Pilate. Not of rebellion, but of mystery.
After several more weeks of investigation, Justus discovered that Jesus was making his way south to Jerusalem. Justus and his family followed, hoping to learn more. When they finally arrived in Jerusalem, Justus went directly to Pilate, but Pilate didn't seem interested in his findings. The narrow streets of Jerusalem were swarming with throngs of visitors. It was the time of the Passover, and everyone was talking about Jesus. Many were saying that he was the Messiah. Then suddenly, it seemed as though the whole city turned against Jesus. Caiaphas and the chief priests delivered Jesus to be tried for inciting the people to rebellion. Pilate brought Jesus before the angry throng and tried to reason with them, but the bloodthirsty crowd led by Caiaphas would not listen. Pilate finally gave in to their cries and ordered several soldiers to flog Jesus. He then retreated into the palace.
Well, Pilate, are you going to crucify an innocent man?
No, centurion, you are.
I'll have no part of it.
Do my ears deceive me, or do I hear a Roman soldier refusing to obey his superior? What will Caesar say?
I will write a report that will explain everything.
And whom do you suppose that Caesar will believe? A report signed by Herod and me, or a report signed by a lowly centurion? Besides, it is expedient that one man should die for the people.
Spoken like a true puppet of Caiaphas.
Beware, centurion. It would be better for you to kill an innocent man than to disobey orders. You wanted the opportunity to prove yourself. You have it.
Jesus, bled and died, cleansing.
centurion, one of the wealthier Jews, has been asked to be given the body of Jesus for burial. Is Jesus dead already?
Yes, he died about the ninth hour.
Why did he die so soon?
I can't explain it. As Jesus hung there on the cross, he seemed to be bearing far greater burdens than the pain of that cross. Then the darkness came, the thick, heavy darkness. So I ordered the torches to be lit. When I looked up at Jesus, he was staring right at me. And he whispered, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I felt like the vilest, most wretched sinner that ever lived. Then, about the ninth hour, he cried, "Father, into thy hands I commend my spirit." And he was dead. It wasn't like I took his life. It seemed as though he willingly gave it. Suddenly, the earth shook, and the rocks around my feet split wide open. Truly, this man was the Son of God.
Don't be foolish, Justice. Today has been difficult for all of us. Now, are you sure that Jesus was dead?
Yes, I'm quite sure. I even thrust my spear into his side so that there would be no question.
Pilate, the Sanhedrin requests the guards be put outside of the tomb of Jesus. Immediately.
Are you not content now that he is dead?
This deceiver had said that he was going to rise after the third day. His accomplices that he calls disciples may try to steal the body of Jesus and then spread the rumors that he rose again. If this were to happen, the last deception will be worse than the first one.
Very well, Caiaphas. You shall have your guard. Justice, go with Caiaphas and see that the tomb is made secure.
No.
The stone is to be...
No, I killed Jesus. I cannot bear to see his body again. No, please.
Centurion.
I killed him.
Get control of yourself. Caiaphas, the guard shall be directly responsible to you. Since you have destroyed his life, now you shall protect his body.
His blood be upon us and on our children.
Something Caiaphas had said haunted Justice. Jesus had prophesied that he would rise from the dead. Of course, it was absurd, but still the thought terrified him to the very depth of his soul. If Jesus were God, and if he did rise from the dead, what would Jesus do to the man who had crucified him?
No. No, I see him.
Justice,
He's looking at me. He's
wake
coming
up,
for me. Jesus, no,
Justice,
I didn't.
Justice, wake
no.
up!
Helena!
Justice,
sorry.
You can't go on like this. You haven't slept or eaten for 3 days.
Father, are you all right?
Yes, son, there's nothing to fear.
The head servant says there's a soldier waiting at the door who wants to speak with you.
Please tell him I'll see him at a later hour.
He says it's urgent, Father.
Titius, what are you doing here? Who's guarding the tomb?
No one, sir.
Where are the other men?
They reported to Caiaphas, sir.
And so should you. You're responsible to him, not to me.
But I thought you'd want to know what happened, sir.
Has something gone wrong?
The tomb. It's empty, sir.
What?
Earlier this morning, while I was on duty, the earth began to shake violently. A great light surrounded me, which I thought was lightning. But when I looked up, I saw a figure. His garments was as white as snow. With ease, he rolled that great stone away. And I fell to the ground, trembling.
You've gone mad, Titius.
The other soldiers saw the same thing, sir.
Then you've all gone mad.
No, sir.
I suppose now you're going to tell me that this strange ghost stole the body of Jesus.
No, sir.
Now, Titius, tell me truthfully. Who took the body?
When the stone was rolled away, the body was already gone.
Christ arose, that tomb is empty,
empty, empty,
empty.
You that a dead man could actually return from the grave.
Father, I saw him. I really saw him.
Sit down, Julius. Now, tell us what you're so excited about.
This afternoon, my friends and I were playing soldiers just outside Jerusalem when we saw two men coming down the road. As it got closer, we noticed a third man had joined them, and he was speaking to them. Father, I heard him talking. I saw him. I really saw him.
You saw whom, Julius?
I saw Jesus.
Julius, don't you ever mention the name of that dead man again.
But Mother, he's alive.
You
he really is.
You only thought you saw him. Don't you ever mention the name of that dead man ever again in this household. Do you understand?
But Mother.
Do you understand?
Yes, Mother.
Jesus was alive, and justice could deny the truth no longer. Overpowering fear was the constant companion of justice, and that fear was driving him insane. As a last resort, Helena went to Pilate secretly and convinced him that his governorship would be in danger if Justice, the son of a powerful Roman senator, were to stay in Jerusalem any longer. The next day, Justice received orders from Pilate to return to Rome. When Justice boarded the ship bound for home, he found himself wishing that all memory of the past few months could be left behind. Although he realized that Jesus must be God, Justice refused to make Jesus his God.
Have I a heart of stone, so cold and dark within, that I can view the Savior in anguish for my sin, and never sorrow Savior wounded, but never shed one tear. can I but coldly gaze upon his painful loss? Have I no eyes to see God's Lamb upon the cross? As I behold the blood and view the crucified, that piercing thought o'erwhelms me, 'twas for my sin he died. Lord, make my soul to feel thy suffering on the tree. Lord, break this heart of stone. Lord, make my eyes to see.
When Justus finally set foot again in Rome, his spirit revived. He renewed his loyalty to the gods of Rome by offering many sacrifices in the various temples. He busied himself with all kinds of activity in an effort to crowd out all memory of Jesus. 5 years after Justus and his family arrived in Rome, Helena died while giving birth to a beautiful baby girl named Alyssa. And little Alyssa became the idol of her father's heart. Many years passed. Justus succeeded his father as president of the Senate and became one of the most wealthy and powerful men in the entire Roman Empire. Julius, following his father's example, became a centurion and was sent far to the east. Alyssa grew to be a lovely young woman. She was small in stature and very beautiful in appearance. Justus adored her. Even when Alyssa was almost old enough to marry, Justus cautiously guarded her innocence like a rare jewel. For indeed, purity was rare in Rome. A new emperor took the throne, who was well-liked at first, but with time became more and more wicked. In the emperor's own estimation, He himself possessed three divine virtues. He was history's greatest poet, musician, and lover. He surrounded himself with evil women and weak men who nurtured his base appetites and lavished praise on his meager abilities.
Petronius, does this toga make me look fat?
Oh, no, just healthy.
Did everyone pay their taxes this year?
I believe so, Caesar, but I believe a few Christians paid late after April 15th.
Well, enough of that. Hearken, critics, I shall bless thee with my latest treasure. I spied a gem of beauty rare, with cheeks of pearl and autumn hair, with emerald eyes of softest hue that sparkle like the morning dew. So small and delicate was she, I thought this gem a dream to be. Such charm the gods could not resist, shall soon be mine, if she exist. Well, what do you think of my newest creation, Senator Antonio?
'Tis most clever, noble emperor.
Must honest men always be so dull? What think ye, wise Petronius?
It's terrible.
What?
It's terrible that one man should possess so great a portion of the world's artistic ability. Such beauty makes the gods envious. The verses of mortals croak like a frog. While thy stanzas soar on the wings of grace and splendor, truly it must be frustrating. There's no one to be compared with thee, no one to challenge thy matchless ability.
Yes, 'tis most difficult. That is why I love thee, Petronius, for only thou canst truly appreciate my great art. Tell me, honestly, can you discern anything I must do to my composition to improve it?
Does an eagle ask a sparrow how to fly?
Oh, please, Petronius, I starve for want of criticism.
I shall venture but one humble observation.
Oh, speak on, wise one.
I question whether any mortal woman's beauty is worthy of thy divine poetry.
Thou dost speak truth, noble sage. Great art must have great subject matter.
Oh, incomparable genius. Quickly, historians, write that down. It must be preserved for all ages to come.
And did you see how quickly it came to me? Yes, where was I? Oh, yes, great subject matter. Therein lies my dilemma. My creative powers are hindered by this wretched city. These narrow streets, crude buildings, and foul odors stifle my artistic soul. Oh, if a great earthquake would come and destroy Rome so that I may create a city of great art and beauty, why couldn't some angry god burn this city to the ground?
But most divine Nero, why dost thou speak of the gods?
Speak on, Petronius.
Aren't thou not a god? And think of what great music thou couldst write after being inspired by such a spectacle as the burning of Rome. Such stupid babbling, Petronius, will bring his poetry to life and put people to death. Ah, now the learned senator has decided to speak, just as I wonder whom you love more, the people or the emperor. Now, it would not be in the emperor's best interest to destroy the lives of those who love and serve him. Just as some things are worth more than the lives of your precious peasants.
Well said, Petronius. If life hath no beauty, then life is empty!
I beg thee, blessed Caesar, do not speak so loudly. If thou shouldst strain at thy golden voice, the world would never recover from such a great loss.
Justice was used to such absurd talk in the palace. However, Nero's song stuck in his mind. Even with all of his other women, Nero wanted Alyssa. He wanted to defile one of the few pure things left in Rome. However, there was one obstacle in Nero's path of evil. Senator Justus Antonio. Although Nero had been responsible for the slaying of several senators, he was hesitant to order the murder of Justus. Nero didn't fear Justus, but he feared the people. Justus was one of the few honest men left in the Senate, and so he was popular with the citizens of Rome. Several days later, the House of Justice was unexpectedly filled with rejoicing. Julius had returned to Rome.
You look well, my handsome brother.
My dear sister, certainly all the young noblemen of Rome are battling for your favor.
Oh, yes. In fact, we're in the middle of a battle right now.
Oh? What's this young man's name?
Nero.
Nero? That scoundrel? That devil wants to defile my sister. I'll slit his throat before tomorrow.
Have patience, Julius.
But we must do something.
That's exactly what Nero wants. If we give him an opportunity to question my loyalty, I shall be killed, and Alyssa will be defenseless.
My dear brother, we must do as father says. We have known of Nero's desires for several months and have successfully avoided his grasp.
Come, my children, this is a day for rejoicing. Let us not dwell on such unhappy thoughts. What brings you to Rome, Julius?
I was given charge of a prisoner in Caesarea who had appealed to Caesar. After a long trip with many hazards, we arrived at Rome late yesterday. Early this morning, I turned him over to the captain of the guard.
What is this man's crime?
He is a Christian.
Many months of joy followed. There was only one thing which clouded the happiness of Justice. His son had developed a great fondness for the prisoner who he had brought to Rome.
Julius, you've been visiting this prisoner far too often. Christians are not thought well of here, and Caesar, unfortunately, has eyes everywhere. Your visits with this man must stop before you give Nero the excuse he needs to destroy us all and seize your sister.
Is your fear for Alyssa, or is it for yourself?
Son, those are cruel words.
I'm sorry, Father. You know you haven't been the same since Jerusalem. Alyssa has told me that you still wake up in the middle of the night screaming about Jesus.
Yes, I will carry those haunting memories to my grave.
But you don't need to fear, Father. Would you speak with Paul?
I cannot.
No one would even know about it. Not even the servants. Paul is being kept in a house next to a large inn called the Fisherman's Rest. There's a large underground cavern that's underneath the inn that also extends under Paul's house. I'm taking charge of Paul tomorrow and allowing him to speak at a gathering of Christians in that large cavern.
But Julius, why on earth are you telling me this?
Because I want you to go to the meeting.
But what good could that possibly do?
Paul is a remarkable man, Father. I've seen him heal people, I've seen him be bitten by a deadly snake, and yet suffer no harm. But more importantly, Paul has seen Jesus, and he can lead you to him also.
But Julius, I crucified Jesus. What will your friend Paul say of that?
You don't need to mention that, Father. Tomorrow evening, put on a long hooded cloak and head to the Fisherman's Rest. After you enter, go to the long counter and ask to speak to the owner. When he appears, you must draw a fish on the counter like this. He will answer, "He is risen." You must say, "And he liveth forevermore."
Julius, what you're asking me to do is to risk everything. If it were discovered that I attended such a meeting, I should be killed. And Nero would seize Alyssa. Is my peace of mind worth such a great price?
No, Father, but your eternal soul is.
Alyssa.
I'm sorry, Father. I couldn't help overhearing. Please go to this meeting. Julius has told me so much about Jesus, and I've even thought of becoming a Christian myself, but I could never do anything to hurt you. Please go, Father. Please.
Justice didn't sleep that night. Even after more than 30 years, nearly every time he closed his eyes, he saw the compassionate eyes of Jesus gazing upon him. The next day, Alyssa sent the head servant to find a long, dark hooded cloak for her father to wear. Then late in the afternoon, at Alyssa's urging, Justice set out on foot for the Fisherman's Rest. Soon Justice found himself inside the inn, standing at a long counter.
I would like to speak to the owner of the Fisherman's Rest, please.
You're speaking with him, kind sir.
I understand there is to be a meeting here tonight.
Many merchants meet around my tables to discuss the business of Rome. Whom are you seeking? He is risen.
And he liveth for... I can't speak those words.
I shall take responsibility for this man, Lucan. He will not betray us. Come with me, sir. I'm sorry I was delayed, Father. I'm glad you've come. At the end of the hallway, go through the red door and head down the stairs. If you wish to speak privately with Paul, wait until everyone is gone. From this moment on, we must act as strangers until we meet again at home. I must go now and be with Paul.
As Justice descended the long flight of stairs into the cool, moist darkness, he could see many lanterns glowing. Then he heard singing, such singing as he'd never heard in the temples of Rome. Soon he could distinguish the forms of people, scores of people, hundreds of people. As the singing grew more intense, all eyes turned upward as if imploring some unseen God.
My beloved brethren, Jesus is alive, and his testimony cannot be stopped. My people, the Jews, tried to destroy him when they nailed his body to a cross. But 3 days later, he triumphed over sin and death when he arose from the grave. I know that he is alive. I have seen him. Persecution is increasing, and yet our God shall have the victory. He has overcome, and we shall overcome. Jesus arose from the dead, and we shall also rise. Brethren, fear not. Rather, let us rejoice evermore. For Jesus Christ is risen and liveth forevermore.
Oh,
Christians left the meeting very slowly and cautiously. Justus concealed himself under his cloak in a corner and waited until everyone had gone.
Centurion.
Oh, I thought everyone had gone. What do you wish, sir?
I wish to speak with Paul.
Very well. I shall wait above in Paul's quarters. Please take as long as you like, sir.
Good evening, Senator Antonio.
You know me?
You and I are old friends. We did business together almost 35 years ago.
Who are you?
Senator, I'm surprised you've forgotten so quickly. I sold you the finest tents in all the Roman Empire.
Saul? Saul of Tarsus?
Your memory serves you well.
But you hated Jesus.
Yes, and I hated his followers too. In fact, after you left Jerusalem, I began doing all I could to destroy them. But one day, as I was on my way to Damascus, Jesus struck me blind with a great light and revealed to me that he himself is the Messiah, the Son of God. Now he has forgiven me for all my sin.
But why do men need forgiveness?
Because every one of us is a sinner who will live somewhere forever. You will either spend eternity in the flames of hell, paying the penalty of your sin, or you will spend eternity in heaven with God, forgiven and cleansed by the blood of Jesus.
Then my sin will surely drag me to hell.
No, Justice. Jesus can forgive your sin too.
But you don't know how great my sin is.
Surely my sins are greater. I have even been responsible for the death of many of his followers.
But I killed Jesus. I'm sorry I bothered you. I'll go now.
Wait. Not only do I forgive you, but Jesus will forgive you also. Even when he was suffering on the cross, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do."
I know. He spoke those words to me. They've haunted me ever since.
But you need not fear any longer. Pray right now. Ask Jesus Christ to save your soul. He will forgive your sins, and you can become a Christian too.
If that decision would involve just me, I would accept Christ right now. But would you ask me to sacrifice the lives of my children?
That is a decision you alone can make. I shall pray that you will.
Rome was burning. Justus had to find Alyssa. He ran up the stairs and out into the smoke-filled street. The sky was red in every direction. He tried to fight his way back into the heart of the city to find Alyssa, but the panic-stricken throngs of people carried him down the narrow streets toward the river. Slaves were killing and looting. Burning houses were collapsing. Men and women were crying and wailing in despair. Billowing flames were spreading and rolling like waves on an angry sea. Nero was enraptured with the spectacle, and with his golden lute in hand, he sang his verses to the hissing flames. After Justus had found refuge on the other side of the river, he discovered that Alyssa had been brought to safety by some of Caesar's guards. However, no one had seen Julius. The next day, Justus, Alyssa, and some of their servants took up residence in one of their large villas outside the city. The fire raged on for 7 horrible days and nights. Justus hunted frantically for Julius, but without success. Only after 2 weeks of searching the ruins did Justus face the tragic reality that his son, like thousands of others, must have perished in the flames. Countless multitudes of homeless, starving Romans plundered the city. Even though Nero distributed great amounts of exquisite foods to all, rebellion and violence were spreading. The raging populace was certain that their emperor had given the command to burn Rome. Nero had to act quickly.
Those ungrateful wretches! I've given them enough bread to bloat them, enough wine to drown them. What more do they want? I know. I shall ride through the multitudes in my golden chariot and sing to them the song I composed while Rome was burning. That will surely melt their hearts, and they will realize that Rome did not burn in vain.
I fear that common dogs have no ears for heavenly poetry.
For once, Petronius is right. The people want revenge.
So, the people want revenge. Well, let's give them a victim. He must surely be someone of great wealth and power.
Senator Antonio is such a man.
What think ye of that, Senator?
I will gladly sacrifice my life for thee, most excellent Caesar.
And I shall gladly receive it. But alas, the people would never believe that you burned Rome, and they would hate me even more for sacrificing you. No, we must find a more likely victim.
By the gods, I had thought of it. Let's not give them one victim. Let's give them hundreds. Yea, thousands. There's a devilish cult in the city who consider the gods of Rome to be evil. Neither do they worship thee, most divine Caesar. I have even heard they predict the world will be destroyed by fire. The people thirst for blood. Let us turn their suspicions on the Christians.
Oh, Zeus, oh, Apollo, why dost thou not deliver us from these cruel wretches who burn the mother of all cities? What tortures befit such a crime? The gods shall inspire me. I shall give my people such splendid amusement that my name will be remembered forever throughout all the ages. I shall drown out the memory of the fire in blood.
Christians to the lions was the angry cry soon heard throughout all of Rome. Savage beasts were imported from the distant regions of the empire. The prisons were packed with Christians, and then the so-called games began. On the first day, gladiators slew the strongest of the Christians. On the next, maidens were sewn up in the skins of animals and pitted against gigantic bears. At the evening games, Christians were placed on crosses, smeared with pitch, and were set afire to provide light for the enthusiastic crowds. The gory spectacles continued for weeks, and Nero's deformed imagination devised every possible form of torture and death. Rome was drunk with blood. The bulging prisons were slowly emptied, and finally, the last day of the games arrived. Anticipation filled the air, for everyone knew that Caesar would do his best to provide an unusual climax to end the games. Nero sent a special invitation to Alyssa, requesting her to join him for his final glorious spectacle. To refuse was certain death, so she went, accompanied by her father. After the usual fanfare, the prefect announced that a new contender had challenged Titan, the champion gladiator of Rome. The crowds cheered wildly as Titan entered the arena bearing his favorite weapon, the Roman short sword. His massive, freshly oiled body had been bronzed by the sun, and his huge arms seemed to be chiseled out of stone. His shoulders were broad enough to carry an ox. All eyes turned to the opposite side of the arena to see who the brave new challenger would be. A pale, emaciated Christian slowly emerged and stumbled to the center of the amphitheater, being helped along by two Praetorian guards. Long weeks in a foul prison had taken their toll. The Christian's body had been racked by disease. He was mockingly dressed like a gladiator. The guards forced a sword into the hands of their prisoner, but when they released their hold on him, he staggered and fell into the bloody red sand. The crowd murmured with displeasure. There was obviously no contest. Nero nervously gave the sign for the combat to begin. Titan began to close in on his victim. Suddenly, Senator Antonio leaped into the arena and ran toward the helpless Christian. At that moment, the feeble young man raised his eyes and shouted, "Father, no!" Nero smiled with satisfaction. His plan had worked perfectly. Soon, Alyssa would be his. Justice took the sword from his son's hand, and Titan slowly moved toward his nude opponent. As the crowd prepared to watch their beloved senator die, they went into a frenzy. Many were jeering at Nero, and others were calling for mercy. Justice still had the stance and movements of a trained gladiator, but age had robbed him of his strength and speed. For a short time, it appeared as though there might be a contest, but it soon became obvious that Titan was merely playing with his victim. Suddenly, with brute strength, Titan locked swords with Justice and forced the noble senator to his knees. He raised his sword for the kill. At that moment, Julius gathered all of his strength and leaped onto the back of Titan in an effort to save his father. The gladiator quickly turned, throwing Julius to the ground, and with one stroke opened a large gaping wound across the chest of Julius. Justice seized the opportunity and drove his sword deep into the body of the champion of Rome. Titan fell dead. The excitement of the crowd surpassed anything seen in the arena before. The crowd stamped their feet and howled their approval. Justus hurried to Julius, who was dying, and took his son in his arms.
Father, he is risen.
Don't speak now, Julius. Save your strength.
Father, he is risen.
Yes, son, and he liveth forevermore. Lord Jesus, I know that I am a sinner, and I know that only thou art great enough to forgive my sin. I now accept thee as my Savior.
Noble Senator, I regret that your son is dead, but I also regret that he was a Christian.
I also regret that he is dead, Caesar, but I am proud that he was a Christian.
Am I to believe that the most noble senator in all of Rome finds some significance in the death of this poor, ignorant Jew?
Jesus is not dead, Caesar. My own son saw him alive 3 days after he was crucified.
I have also heard of others that were taken down from the cross before they were dead and lived to tell about it.
Yes, but Jesus died on his cross. I know because I crucified him.
You, the dignified president of the Senate, crucified this worthless, deluded peasant?
I was the centurion under Pontius Pilate who ordered the crucifixion of Jesus. He was dead, there was no question. I even thrust my spear into his side, just to be sure.
What? Have you become one of his followers also?
I can do naught else.
You're a fool, Justice, and all of Rome shall witness the course of a fool. Archers, prepare!
Go back, Alyssa.
Please, Father, I want to stand at your side.
Gracious lady, walk away from your father to safety. There is no charge against you.
But I also am a Christian.
Certainly you are, out of respect for your father. Now leave his side. Your loyalty will do him no good. I do not wish to harm you. He has chosen the course of a fool.
I would rather die with the fool than live under a ruler who sets fire to his own empire.
Then you shall have your desire. Archers, make ready. They both shall die. The name Antonio shall be destroyed forever.
Yes, Nero, and one day you also will die. And even your name will someday be forgotten. But the name of Jesus Christ will endure forever and ever. Because Jesus Christ is risen.
Archers, take aim. Kill them, quickly. Kill them. Kill them both. Archers, kill them. Kill them.